Hi, my name is Jonathan, and I'm happy to welcome you to my Hope talk on higher order programming with effects and handlers, but without first-class functions. In this talk, I present our language effect. You can find our language online. The website features an interactive editor and a REPL, so I invite you to experiment with the language. Some parts of this presentation are covered in our conditionally accepted Uppsala paper. In particular, the paper features a full formalization of the static and dynamic semantics. Before we're getting started, I want to acknowledge my collaborators, Philipp Schuster and Klaus Ostermann, that contributed to the design of this language. This talk, like our language, is about three things. Effect handlers, a recent mechanism to structure complex control flow patterns. Effect safety, that is, guaranteeing that all effects are eventually handled. And effect polymorphism, that is, describing programs which are polymorphic in the used effects. While handlers and effect safety are really important, if this talk is about anything, then effect polymorphism. But what is effect polymorphism? Let us consider this example from Dan Lyon's paper on COCA that illustrates parametric effect polymorphism. The catch function is polymorphic in both the value type A and the effect row E. It expects two argument functions, an action and a handler H, and uses the handler to remove the exception effect from action. Both action and the handler H can have additional effects E. We call this form of effect polymorphism parametric effect polymorphism, since catch is parametric in E. Parametric effect polymorphism means that we explicitly bind and reference effect variables, E in this case. Effect polymorphism is great since it allows us to use the catch function with many different argument functions for action, using potentially different effects. Parametric effect polymorphism is common practice in popular research languages like COCA, Frank, or Helium. However, from a practical point of view, parametric effect polymorphism can quickly become verbose and complicated. Programmers are then confronted with type errors like or this, or like this. While these example error messages are from the language COCA, the problem itself is not specific to COCA, which is a great language. We, that is the Effect Language research team, agree with Roman Elizarov, one of the Kotlin developers, that working programmers should not be confronted with parametric effect polymorphism. And we are in good company with that opinion. Multiple researchers and language designers have stated that surfacing effect polymorphism should be avoided. For example, Lindley et al. Say that in designing Frank, we have sought to maintain the benefits of effect polymorphism whilst avoiding the need to write effect variables in source code. And similarly, Lyon states that in practice, though, we wish to simplify the types more and leave out obvious polymorphism. And those languages go to great length to hide parametric effect polymorphism from the user. However, we believe that hiding the complexity is not enough, since it might still surface in error messages or more advanced use cases, potentially confusing the startled user even more. These concerns are a major motivation of the effect language, which explores a different design space with different trade-offs. The effect system is designed to cater to everyday programmers. In particular, in the effect language, there simply is no support for parametric effect polymorphism. Also, neither source type system nor core type system feature parametric effect polymorphism. It truly does not exist. Since it does not exist, users cannot and do not have to write effect variables, and users cannot be confused by type errors that mention effect variables. Here is the same example in effect. Effect introduces a different form of effect polymorphism, which we call contextual. I will go into the details later. For now, it suffices to see that there are no effect variables in the signature. After this talk, I hope that we synchronized on our understanding of effect polymorphism and that you have a good idea of how the effect language enables effect polymorphism without effect variables. I hope that in the discussion following this presentation, we can clarify technical details, talk about implications, limitations, and ways to mitigate those limitations. The core observation underlying contextual effect polymorphism is the following. If a function cannot leave the dynamic scope it is defined in, we do not need to track its effects. Everything in the effect language is built around this observation. While this might be obvious to some of you, let me illustrate this observation with an example. Let us assume the following piece of code. Here, the local function definition f uses a get effect with the following signature. We enclose f in a handler for the get effect, which handles get by always resuming with 42. So running this example will yield 84. If we know that f cannot leave the dynamic scope of the enclosing handler, then it is safe to not track effects on f. In particular, we can annotate the local function f with an empty effect set. Again, this is only safe if we can guarantee that f cannot leave the scope it is defined in. In many languages, there would be multiple ways for f to leave its scope. By simply returning it, by writing it to a mutable variable, or by closing over it. So, how do we prevent f from leaving the scope it is defined in? Oswald et al. Introduced a type system that distinguishes between first-class values and second-class values. First-class values can be returned and stored, but cannot close over second-class values. In contrast, second-class values cannot be returned or stored, but in turn can close over other second-class values. In effect, we make a similar distinction. It is actually very easy. We treat all data as first class. That includes built-in types like int or boolean, but also user-defined algebraic data types. In our type system, we speak of value types. In contrast, all blocks are second class. This includes function definitions, function arguments, resumptions, and capabilities. To avoid confusion, we typically do not speak of functions, but of blocks. Similarly, in our type system, we speak of block types. We will see what that means in a second. Let me point out that this implies that in effect, there simply are no first-class functions. We thus killed every functional programmer's favorite feature. The distinction between values and blocks also shows up in the syntax of our language, both in abstractions, where we expect value parameters in parentheses, and block parameters in braces, and in application, where again, value arguments are passed in parentheses and block arguments are passed in braces. To drive that point home again, blocks in effect are second class. They cannot be returned, they cannot be stored in mutable variables, they cannot be passed to constructors of algebraic data types, and they can also not be passed as arguments to effect operations. So since a block cannot leave the dynamic scope it is defined in, we do not need to track its effect. However, tracking the effect is sometimes desirable, as I will illustrate now. In our example, by annotating the effects on a block, the user can choose whether an effect should be handled at the call side of the block or whether it should be handled at the definition side of the block. The different annotations not only affect the typing, but also the operational semantics, as we will see. But first, let us review our typing judgments for blocks. In our typing judgment for def, we can see exactly this. Some effects, epsilon 0, are annotated on the function f and thus need to be handled at the call side of f. All other implementation effects, epsilon 0 prime, without epsilon 0 have to be handled at the definition side of our block F. Here I want to highlight one important point. Like other recent approaches to effect handlers by Zhang and Myers, Bernatsky and colleagues, in the effect language we establish some form of lexical scoping of handlers. To understand this, let us assume the following higher order function. The function takes a block prog and handles the get effect by always resuming with 1. So our example will result in the value 1. Similarly, running f under always 1 will yield 2. However, if we now change the annotated type of f to not mention get anymore, the get effect has to be handled at f's definition side, and now the example yields 84. Similarly, if we change the annotated type of always 1 to not mention get, the handler in its implementation does not handle anything, and our example prints 84, regardless of the effect annotation on our block F. Our design decisions result in a different reading of type signatures. Traditionally, one would read the above signature as: given the value of type A, the function produces a value of type B and potentially uses effect E. While in effect, we read it as: given the value of type A, the function produces a value of type B and requires the calling context to handle effect E. This different reading also has an effect on the notion of purity. While in traditional effect systems, one would understand F to be a pure function if it does not mention any effects, in the effect language, F simply admits no direct observation of effects to its caller. That is, we cannot handle any effects used by the function F. However, F can use arbitrary effects that need to be handled at its definition side. Only in the special case of top-level functions, we can conclude that a function with an empty effect set is actually pure. Viewers familiar with exceptions in Java or effects in multicore or Camel might be surprised to see that our examples have the desired operational semantics. In particular, this example yields 42, even though dynamically the ignore handler installs a handler for get that would resume with 1. Our operational semantics is designed in concert with the static semantics, such that it truthfully follows what the types promise. The type of ignore promises that it cannot observe, that is, handle effects of prog. To obtain the correct operational semantics, we again follow the idea of lexical scoping and translate effect programs to capability parsing style. In particular, for every effect in the set of effects, F1 to Fn, we introduce an additional term level argument. If we translate our program using the handler ignore, we obtain the following. The block passed to ignore lexically closes over the get capability introduced by the surrounding handler. In contrast, if we translate our program using always 1, we introduce another binding occurrence of the capability get, which shadows the outer one. Our runtime follows a generative semantics and thus prevents accidental capture. Related to the topic of effect polymorphism is another important topic: effect encapsulation. To discuss effect encapsulation, let us assume another effect called abort. We also define a handler maybe that handles abort into an optional value. In the following, we adapt an example from the JFP paper Doobie Doobie Doo by Convent et al. But first, we need some prerequisites. We define a handler feed that handles our get effect by reading values from a given list. In case there are no more elements, we use the abort effect. We can now compose the two handlers to obtain a new handler called feedMaybe. that uses the maybe handler to handle the abort effect, which is used by feed. In the function user, we call feed maybe with a block that performs the abort effect. But what is the expected result of running this example? There are multiple possible outcomes. First, in a language like MultiCore or Camel, the abort effect would be handled by the dynamically closest handler, which is maybe, and the result thus would yield maybe. In languages like Coca or Frank, the composed feed maybe handler would simply not type check as is. The inferred effect in Coca would mention the abort effect on proc, since it is used under a maybe handler. This also correctly reflects the operational semantics of dynamic handler search, but leaks information into the type signature of feed maybe. It breaks effect encapsulation. In order to restore effect encapsulation, those languages offer some form of term-level lifting annotation. The lifting annotation indicates that any abort effect in proc should be lifted over the next handler, that is maybe in this case. As a result, the signature of proc now no longer mentions abort. Lifting has operational content, since when dynamically searching for the correct abort handler, lift informs the runtime that the next handler should be skipped. In effect, the above example just type checks as is. The mandatory effect signature on proc informs the operational semantics to only bind a capability for get, but not for abort. The user code correctly closes over the abort capability, and the program prints aborted. To summarize, the combination of type-directed semantics and the translation to capability passing style allows us to not require any term-level lifting annotations. The semantics just fulfills what the types promise. I hope that I convinced you that effect offers an interesting lightweight form of effect polymorphism. Parametric effect polymorphism simply does not exist in the language. We also have seen that effect annotations influence the operational semantics. In particular, other than in languages like Frank, it is not necessary to adapt computation using term-level lifts. This simplicity comes with trade-offs. At the moment, we do not support first-class functions, and reasoning about purity is restricted. An empty effect set does not imply that a function is indeed pure. It just implies that we, as the caller, cannot handle any effects. Before I conclude, I want to mention that my colleague Philip Schuster is presenting our work on efficient compilation for effect handlers at ICFP. In ongoing work, we are applying this strategy to efficiently compile effect programs. This concludes my talk, and I'm looking forward to the discussions.